Good afternoon, dear participants. As instructed, hope you all are having the water bottle with you, filled one. There would be an activity related. Yes, and participants, you all are requested. Ma'am is keen on constantly upgrading her skills, has enhanced her knowledge by completing many national and international workshops and training. Ma'am is a certified read-on therapist, licensed brain gym movement facilitator, certified matrix re-imprinting practitioner, and a certified emotional freedom technique practitioner. I think, ma'am, we wouldn't have found anybody more competent and an expert in the field to conduct today's session. Ma'am, on behalf of Gujarat Research Societies, Hansraj Jeevandas College of Education, our principal, Madam Dr. Anita Swami, the entire HSE faculty, and the participants present here, I extend a warm welcome to you, ma'am. Ma'am, we hand over the session to you, and if you require anything, you can please ask us. Participants, just one small instruction. If you have any questions, you can post it in the Zoom chat box. And you can also post the questions on the WhatsApp group that we have. Madam will be taking the questions and those will be answered during the question answer session and also in between the interaction. So ma'am, over to you, and we hand over the entire session to you. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you so much. It was a real extended, I would say, introduction and a run through for me for all my, degrees and education. So thank you so much. And I would really appreciate Principal Ma'am and all the staff members of the college to, you know, take up this topic, which is really a need of the hour today with all the conditions what we are in. And, you know, a lot of people have anxiety and they are looking for solutions. And when they are looking for solutions for, their anxiety or, how to cope up, I think these are very quick fix techniques what they can, just connect to. And today our endeavor, my endeavor and, your efforts of making this webinar happen is actually to just, make people aware about it, make all the students here and all of us aware about how and what is happening. Okay. So I would just like to do a screen share and start my presentation. Okay, so the presentation starts with the topic substance abuse and its ill effects. Okay, so since this is a very heavy topic, what we are going to deal with, and to understand this whole scenario of why and what and where, all the questions, before I actually start the presentation, I would just like to take 5 minutes of yours. And I invite all of you to do a small 4-step brain gym exercise. I'm not going into much details about, what is the technique and, why. I'll be just explaining why we're doing it. So basically, I always felt that anything to understand, we need a very open mind and we need to be in the present, because obviously with this technique coming in, with this topic coming in, we are all very, curious to know. And I don't want that our anxieties or our, past or the future or anything. So let us be in the present before we start, even understanding this topic. So I would just, ask each one of us to just scan the body. So I'm going to ask the questions and, you can take these 5 minutes of, just to connect. So for me also to connect with all of you and for all of you to connect with me. So as I take you through the question session, you can either close your eyes or just look into a distance as you do a small body scan, okay? So I invite you all to scan your body. Notice your breathing. Is it deep or is it shallow? Any aches, pains, or tight muscles you feel in the position you are sitting or standing, do you feel evenly balanced or comfortable as you sit or stand? Is your mind foggy, agitated, or clear? And what are the emotions present right now? In the present, what is our emotional state? Now, after scanning this body, doing the body scan, we are going to experience pace. Now, pace is a four-step brain gym warm-up exercise. So now you can all open your eyes and, we just get ourselves prepared for this. So the purpose of doing this exercise is to be in the present, to feel positive, to feel active, to feel clear and feel energetic. Because this is one technique which I have been using since almost more than 10 years. And I have always felt that whenever I do this four-step exercise, which is just a 1 minute for each step, it just brings me to the present. And when we are in the present, our brain is much more active, clear, positive, and energetic for learning. And these are all the requirements for a better learning or understanding. Okay. Now, in the pace process, we always start from backwards. So we do it in the cat manner. Okay. So the first step is I invite you all to have a sip of water. You all have water with you, as ma'am had already instructed. And just take a sip of water. So as you take the sip of water, just feel the water going inside your body midline. Just one sip, and you feel the water flowing through your mouth and just taking it inside the body midline. The second step would be to go and do clear. So how do we clear is make a U, two fingers and the thumb. And this is our collarbone. Okay. One hand, the other hand, which is free, will go on the navel. Okay. So I'm just going to stand and show so that everybody is able to see me. Okay, so one hand is on the navel, the other hand, two fingers and thumb is on my collarbone, and I slide it down a little bit to, this is my sternum, the center of the chest, and across the sternum are these two points. So I'm just going to, stimulate these two points, little bit massage it, okay, and as I massage it, I'm also going to look in the horizontal movement. So I'm moving my eyes horizontally along the space I have. And also remember to breathe, which is a very important technique for all of us. So this is not where I'm teaching you. You can just observe me. And if you feel like, you can just keep doing it. There's nothing right or wrong. The way right now, this is the first time we are doing it. So it's absolutely fine, even if you're not doing it very perfectly. Okay. And once you feel like, so there is no fixed time for doing it. So you can do it 3 times or 4 times or 5 times. Your ideally it is 1 minute. And then we change the hand. So this hand would come on the navel. And this is where, again, I put it on the collarbone. And I just slide it down, center of the chest. And there I feel these two dips. As I move my shoulders, I can just feel these two dips. And I again start stimulating these two points. This is helping me to clear my thoughts. And I'm moving my eyes horizontally, left to right. And breathing along the way. The third step is active, A. So this is how I'm going to get active is cross-crawls. So I'm doing cross-crawls. So I'm touching my right hand to my left knee. You can do it sitting, you can do it standing, the way you want. And left hand to the right knee. So it's opposite knee, touching your opposite knee. Very slowly come back, then again touching the opposite knee and come back. Okay, so the name of the exercise is cross crawls. So as many times as you feel like doing it, 4 times or 5 times. So just to start with, just feel little activeness and then you start going into the flow. So just touching the opposite knee. So we did water, we did brain buttons. This is the name of the exercise, brain buttons. We did cross crawls. And the last, which is one of my favorites. So I'm going to cross my feet like this. So my hands are depicting this, but my feet are crossed like this. Left over right or right over left doesn't matter. We are going to do both ways. So whatever is comfortable to you, just cross your ankles, the feet, I would say. Okay, so you cross your feet and then you also straighten your hand, turn it around and clasp it and bring it close to your chest. I'm going to demonstrate it again. Straighten your hand, you know, turn it and then bring it close to your chest. And in this position, we are going to do breathing. So I'm taking my tongue up the palate. And slowly I open my hands, I open my feet, and I do it the other way. So left over right, it was first, and now it is right over left. And again, I do the same step for the hands, and I do my breathing. Slow, deep breathing, touching the tongue up the palate. Okay? And the second step of this exercise is bringing your hands close, you know, touching all the hands left and right in front of the navel and same breathing. So your body will automatically tell you how much to do it. And this is really beneficial. So all of you who could manage to, you know, even do one step was great. And this was just a way for me to connect to all of you before I really start my presentation. Okay. Okay. So you can do the body scan again. Remember, we did a small body scan and, you know, you can notice for your breathing, any, you know, pains and aches, the present emotions. How's your mind feeling now? Are you feeling balanced? Are you feeling comfortable while you're sitting or standing? So if anybody would like to share, if they could manage to do anything, or we can just go ahead with our presentation. So this was just a way, it was a very, this is a very, you know, brilliant way of connecting yourself to your present. And it is a very important for us to be in the present, to, you know, take any learning or take any understanding. I just thought to share this because, as we know, we have all the students on the panel and even the teachers. And we need to do a lot of focus and, you know, learning while we are learning. So this was just that attempt to do it. Okay. And I am just going directly to my presentation as we start. So now I would like you all, just before I, you know, start the presentation, I would say that this is going to be a very interactive presentation. And I'm not here just for lecturing. I'm here to, you know, also understand the understanding what you all have about this topic. So I would really request you all to put it in the chat box, you know, what is the first thought which comes to your mind when you read the word substance abuse? So the moment you have this, you know, word coming in your mind, you are reading this on the screen. So, and ma'am, if anyone...
we are not able to...
And the chat is disabled.
Yes, we have enabled the chat. You all can start putting your reactions. Yes,
thank you, ma'am.
Can see. Yes.
Okay. So as we heard this word substance abuse, what is the first word which is coming, you know, in your thought? So I give you a minute. So maybe, you know, everybody can just write it and then we can just start. Any one of you can just start reading it for me as the words are coming in. As I can see, the chat has already started, you know, words have already started coming in. So.
Yes, Sumita ma'am, I'll do that for you. Yes. Most of the responses as we see associated with this is drugs addiction, drugs and alcohol, just addiction, then harmful use of anything to change mood, drugs and smoking, overuse of anything like alcohol, tobacco along with drugs and alcohol. Addiction to harmful substances, which are not good for our body. Using something in excess.
Yes.
Substance-related disorder, adverse use of things, that are not preferred at a day-to-day basis.
Yes.
Mood stimulator, to be in hallucination. Somebody has written that. Slow death. Mostly young people are involved nowadays.
Yeah.
Harmful physical and for the mental health. Excessive use of toxic substances like drugs and alcohols. Yeah, these were the repeated ones I just told you. Yes. Sure.
So we understand that the first thing what comes to our mind is, you know, the word abuse. You know, it is something which is making us away. Actually, the use is something which is of utility. Now, when we break the word abuse, ab is something which is taking you away from that use. So some substances, some things which are really taking you away from your present, from your connectivity to life. So that is the, you know, thought which is coming. And I'm just going to show you a few words. Some of those words would be what you have taken, written about it. And some of the words would be which are new. So we have this whole, scenario of words which connects to drug abuse, which connects to alcohol, you know, and we all know that somewhere it is making us addict. It is connecting us to dependence. It is connecting us to excess of anything. Okay. Now, also what we are going to discuss is the types of substance abuse. The three major categories what we are going to, you know, cover in this topic today is about alcohol. Then there is these drugs, which are the legal drugs, you know, and some are the illegal ones, as we know. And a lot of countries, you know, in US, like marijuana has been given, they have allowed it to use it for anxiety. They are using it and they are getting good results. Even for children with autism, you know, when they have those seizures and everything, it's being used. Some of the drugs, which are also like, you know, off the shelf, what we get in, not in India, but definitely in other countries. And also about nicotine, which is smoking. So these are the three major, drugs, substance abuse, what we are going to use. So I want you to understand first is this is something which just starts as a habit. This is just something which is just starting as a first time. Okay. It is the day one, you will not reach to a level of addict or a substance abuser or, you know, substance use disorder. These are the common terminologies what we use for a person or for a situation a person is. But definitely, I have a question to ask to my audience today, that do you think that substance use disorder or substance abuse has any comorbidity with the mental health disorder or the symptoms? So this is a question which is coming to all of you right now. You know, you can just answer yes or no, or if there is any other viewpoint, I really appreciate to give your feedback about it, because from here, I'm going to take you to the journey of how a substance abuser is, you know, the real journey. So I want you to understand that I need to understand what is your understanding about this whole subject. So do you think that somewhere the mental health disorders or symptoms, you know, like whatever it is, like anxiety or some personality disorders, or some, are there really some people who are actually prone to this? Or even me and you can become someday, you know, if we are in that situation, even me and you can be a victim of this. Or is there a very specific population which really gets into this whole zone of substance use disorder? So ma'am, I would really appreciate if you can just, you know, give me a few comments which are coming in.
Yes. Yes, ma'am. Most of them have written yes for the question that has been posed. And I can just see one no. Rest, everybody has written yes for the question.
And okay, so we understand that this is really a comorbid condition where, you know, this could lead to mental health disorder, or maybe the vice versa, I would say, you know. Why we look at only one side, you know. Sometimes mental health, somebody is having some issues with their own life issues, and then they take this as a resort. Even this, that could be, you know, a situation where you get into this zone. So now I'm going to do a little, situational thing, you know, as I go to my next slide. Okay, so this is the, so my question is, what is the profile of a substance user? Okay, so somebody who's using the substance, abuser, I would say. So as you can see on the screen, there's this person sitting with his head down, you know, like this is the situation. Okay, so imagine you have this person sitting in front of you who is an addict or who is using this, you know, any of these, smoking or alcohol or drugs. And you can just imagine, you know, what is the body language. So if I'm sitting here today in front of you and I'm the person who is just, you know, what is the profile? So when I say profile, I want you to understand the physical profile, the mental profile, you know, the emotional profile of that person. So anything, if you can tell me, you know, if because I said it's an interactive, and I also want you to understand that if this person is sitting in front of you for a minute, if each one of you can, you know, just go put your head down and look down and just imagine yourself, just for a minute, think that you are one of them, you know, you are in that position. And how do you feel about it? So just if any one of you can, you know, really tell me that if you can do that, and for a minute, we just feel that thing. How do you feel? And then if
helpless.
You can...
Ma'am, do you feel helpless?
Wonderful, wonderful. Perfect. Helpless. Any other comments coming in, ma'am? Then you can please let me know. So we said helpless. That's the feeling. You know, if you are putting your head down and I'm at the same time telling you, be happy, life is okay. So you felt helpless. Any other comments coming in?
Yes, participants.
Ma'am?
Yes.
Ma'am, unsatisfied with our own selves.
Wonderful, wonderful. Unsatisfied.
Ma'am?
Yes, Soumya?
Demotivated.
Wonderful. Demotivated, helpless, unsatisfied.
Can I speak?
Yes, Amrita.
Yeah, it is. I have no resort left. I have no resort. I don't have any other place to go to. So I moved to Greece.
Yes. And how do we think that we can, what can be done with this person? You know, like when I say this person sitting in front of you, does any one of us really want to go near this person? Or does any one of us have the, you know, the will to help this person or support this person or understand this person? What is this person feeling? Because we went into the field of this person. We just went into the shoes of this person and we understood that we feel helpless. We feel there is no resort left. You know, it's absolutely very, you know, feeling of lost. So how do we approach this person? Do you think we can approach this person, or do you think any of the other people can approach you if when you are feeling really lost, really helpless, no resort left, no hope left, and at the same time, people are telling you to be happy? You know, we have all the people giving us a lot of gyan, you know, as teachers, we also give a lot of gyan. So at the same time, we have this thing coming up. Imagine what this person is going through.
This person, yes, Sumita, miss. Yeah. The participants have put the response in the chat box. They do feel that we can approach them, and that can be through empathy, with love, and support. Definitely we can help these people.
Okay, so all the people who have written this, I really appreciate. Now I am an alcohol addict. I'm holding this glass. I'm sitting with my head down and you are showing me all empathy, all love, everything. I'm still holding to this glass. If ma'am, you can show me your empathy and love and support, or maybe you can give me one sentence and see if my body language changes. Let's do a role play. I think we all understand the best with the role play. I'm an addict. I'm holding
on. So, ma'am, so depending on the situation, if you are sitting or in a club or somewhere, I would like to distract you by saying, can you just keep the glass and can we dance first so that you distract yourself and first stop doing the abuse in the first place. That will be my first step.
Wonderful, ma'am. Wonderful. So you said you will definitely try to distract me, but this is what I'm holding on to because this is my support. this is my communication. This is, I'm something holding on to. I don't want to get up. I don't want to dance.
Ma'am, it will never be one instance where I can change a person. It will be a slow process. So it's not that I can get your glass down right there, right now, and that is the way I'm going to help you. It'll have to be a process. I do not leave you after this particular meeting of mine. That's what I would say.
So you all understood that when we went into the shoes of that person, you felt like a bechara. You felt like, you know, people are just standing on your head and telling you something, but I'm in that position. You know, I don't want to do things. I don't want to understand because this is something I'm holding on to. It could be my glass. It could be just my ciggy, or it could be just, you know, drugs, whatever I'm addicted to. And for some people, it is work also. You know, as we see the pictures, you can see for some people, it is gaming also. So addiction is just not substance abuse. You know, addiction could be anything, right? So now let's understand, like you, all of you said, it is situational. So let us understand what is the situation this person can be. So what, where, when? Now we have these three questions coming in as we connect to the situation of this person. Okay. How did this person reach to a stage where we call him an addict or a substance abuser, to be precise? Was it the first time? Can this happen the first time? Does any of you think that this can happen the first time and you connect that person to abuser? No, this cannot happen at the first time. It's a process. Like each one of you said, when you want to, you know, discontinue this, it'll be a process. So same way, when that person got connected, that was also a process. Okay. So what is the process? Now, what are the conditions? Let's take an example. I'm at a party where I have gone with my friends, okay, and I'm just standing. I'm a vegetarian, teetotaler, non-smoker person. And I've come to a party of my friends where everybody is having, you know, drinks and smoking. And I'm just standing in a corner, okay? And now my friend just approaches me and just tells me to, you know, have a sip. You know, how do we friends really, people who drink or smoke, they just tell, have a sip. Nothing wrong, you know? And I say, no, my family doesn't allow me. No, I cannot do this. It's absolutely prohibited in my family. And what do you think that person would say to the other person to just motivate me to even have a sip? Maybe he says, any of you, any comments coming in? If you can just, maybe if anyone...
A sip won't hurt or a drink won't hurt.
Wonderful. So people are telling me, you know, Pips, it's okay. You know, you can just taste it. And what is the next statement we give it? Have a taste. Enjoy it. So what are people trying to connect me to is, it's something good. It's not bad. Just try it. So what is the information given to my brain at the first command is, it's okay. You know, just try it. Just have a sip. You will enjoy it. You will feel good. And who doesn't in this world want to feel good or enjoy life? Okay. So maybe at the first time I just refused, I rejected. Second situation, scene change. Today, probably I got my result or I got into, you know, I'm at my home and I have my parents fighting in. And again, I'm meeting my friends today and I've got in a little low mood. I'm not in a good mood. And, you know, my friends are celebrating and again having a party and they're saying, okay. And today I just take this sip. I listen to them. I connect with them. I take a sip. And in spite of all that situation, what I came in, I could get a good sleep. I could have a very nice, you know, time at the party. So what is the condition is, it is not always connected to a negative situation. It is sometimes connected to a positive situation, most of the times. Because people connect to social, like we say, social drinkers or social smokers, they are the people who, you know, connect in a gathering. So the questions, what, where, and when is, what is the situation? It's always, most of the time, a positive situation which you get connected to. Because it's something positive for your brain. where it is the social meetings. It is the place of gathering. You would never find that a person has become addict. You know, when he started, it started with a social meeting. It never started with one person having a smoking or a, you know, drinking alone in the room. That is the last stage the person would reach to. And when it is either when you are in a mood for celebration or either when you are given an instruction that you can relax, you can enjoy life. So that is the constant command which is given to our brain. As I move ahead and I, you know, make you understand the red signals for addiction, as we say. So there are these red signals, you know, if like, because now here we are in a forum where we are making an awareness, where we are making an attempt for ourselves to understand for us, and then for understanding of others, you know, when we are looking at somebody and understanding, oh, this person is going into that phase. So what are the physical, behavioral, and emotional, you know, symptoms or signals what we can get? So like, you remember the body language of this person who's sitting like this? Now, I said this person is an addict. So what is the body language? What are my stooping shoulders or my head down? You know, what is my body language? The body language is absolutely of no hope. I'm not giving an eye contact. I'm not in a mood for, you know, even looking at you. I am just lost in my word. Like somebody said, feeling lost. So that is the appropriate feeling, you know. I'm really not looking at how do I look or what, you know, am I presentable? I am not aware about all those things. So my physical body language, my physical signals are not looking at anything which is, you know, that I have to look very nice and I have to really present myself. I'm not aware about all those things. The second thing is the behavioral. Now the behavioral symptoms could range from a very, you know, simple way of just rejecting or repulsion, because here I feel that when I connect to all these things, I'm happy. But when people, what are the people telling me? What are my loved ones giving me this, you know, gyan is just leave it. It is not good for you. Don't drink, don't smoke. So what is my behavioral when somebody is telling me not to do things? What is my brain doing? So for example, if I just make you do it, you know, just close your eyes and think about, you know, you're holding on, just hold on to this and it is going to give you a lot of peace and relaxation. Just give it a try. Just hold on to something and just imagine, I'm going to say this thing, what you're holding on to is giving you a lot of relaxation. It will really calm your brain. You will really feel relaxed and feel very peaceful. So my instruction constantly is, you will feel peace. And at the same time, when I say, do not hold on to this, it is not giving you anything, okay? Please leave this. What are you still doing? You're still holding on to it. You will not even, you know, your body language will also not change. So the constant thing is, that our brain just understands one single instruction, which is connecting to the positive. So my behavior would be, I will feel very frustrated. I will feel very irritable. I will not like to feel, you know, not even feel like talking. Forget connecting or communicating or, you know, anything. I will not like to even connect to the people who are not telling me that, you know, you are a loser. Because that is what our constant language is when we are talking to people around us who are into this zone. We tell them, you know, you can't do anything. So that is the constant feedback I'm giving. And my behavior is turning into an absolute, you know, not able to connect to anybody. And the emotional symptoms definitely are connected to this. My emotions are again lost of hope. I don't have anybody to look forward to. I don't have anything in life to look forward to. And I don't want to, you know, look forward, because I know people have, you know, a lot of withdrawal symptoms when they are not getting connected to, you know, else. So it's a dependence. I'm so much emotionally dependent to my substance abuse things or my drugs or my smoking or alcohol that my emotional connectivity to people is lost. Okay, now let's understand what addiction does to the brain. Okay, I can see a small spelling mistake, and that's okay. So it reads as, what is the hijack? So I use the word hijack because that is what it is doing to our brain. So as you can see on the screen, these are these three hormones, dopamine, serotonin, and oxytocin. Okay, I'm going into a little technical thing. If you feel that I'm going fast, you can stop me and I can slow down and explain you again. Okay, or you can write in the chat box and we can attend to your questions. Now understand, this brain structure of ours is so beautifully made that the pleasure centers of our brain and the addiction centers of our brain are the same ones. So the moment we have something, when the instruction was given to me, please have it, please try it, you know, you will feel relaxed, you will feel peaceful. So what is being activated is my pleasure center of the brain. And it is a reward-driven reinforcement center of learning and addiction, you know. So something which is so strong, I mean, in my whole life, nobody told me that, you know, you be educated, you do this activity or you do this, you know, you do the certification course and you will really feel good. But this is just one drink or one fag. And people have said, please take it. You will feel wow. And I start connecting to it. So my brain starts secreting these three hormones. And these are the three hormones, which are the most wonderful hormones when released from our brain. They really make you feel happy. They really, you know, are the mood regulators. They really make you feel that, wow, this is something which is very positive happening to me. And you really want to, you know, repeat this. So the dopamine is the happy hormone. The oxytocin is the love hormone. You know, feel loved, feel belonged, feel connected. And the serotonin is the mood regulator. So why in my word, when I'm feeling loved, when I'm feeling my mood on a high, you know, people say I feel high when I do this. So why I would not like to feel these things? And in the same way, as my brain is, the neural pathways of my brain are, you know, connecting this whole patterning, this whole process into such a wonderful way of making me feel high, that I don't feel like a loser anymore in my life. I'm on my seventh heaven. Why would I not like to repeat this? When I'm feeling loved, when I'm feeling happy, and when people are telling me, stop this, would you like to stop it? Would you like to stop when you feel loved? Forget how you're feeling loved, but you feel loved. And that feeling is something what you're holding on to every time when you are connecting this. So what is this quick fix I have in my life to feel loved? I hold on to this. I hold on to my cigarette. I hold on to my drugs. Because that is making me, it's a substitute. But how does it matter to me? It is at my own beck and call. I don't have to depend on somebody. Hey, please come and help me. Hey, please, you know, make me feel loved. It's at my own availability. It's when I want it, I can do it. So from a habit, I'm into a slow process becoming an addict. Into a very slow process, I'm moving on to a journey. So imagine a situation where I believe in, like, you know, our brain understand examples. So I'm taking a lot of life situational examples, which many of you would have gone through or even seen people going through it. So for example, today when I have a celebration in my house, you know, me being a very, coming from a very simple family, but today my dad and all my family members decided, let's go for a dinner out. And in that dinner outing, my dad said, you know, let's take a, you know, you also drink with me and have a glass and let's do cheers to your probably celebration. And I'm going for further studies to US and it's a moment of pride and, you know, happiness for my family and it's okay for me to drink. So what is the message for coming to my brain is I'm perfectly, it's fine to, you know, So I'm getting so much of love. I'm feeling so much, you know, happiness around me that it's okay. And I did it. This is the first time I did it. Second time when it happened, probably when I'm in abroad, you know, I'm sitting with my friends and then my friends are also telling me, or, you know, somewhere my you know, people around me, if I'm for work, my boss is telling me to have a sip, you know, try it. And what is my brain doing is exactly these three hormones getting secreted. And my brain is creating that whole situation again, that whole feeling again, that, wow, I'm connecting. That feeling when I got the first time, I connected to this. And at the same time, I got connected to my family. So why would I not drink it? Or why would I not have it? So habit or addiction or substance use at the first time always starts from a positive feeling. It is never a negative feeling. Though what we convert is, and it's a substitution. I hope these two things are very much clear till now from the different ways I have tried to give examples and, you know, try to make it clear. I'm not going into much technical details here because that is all available on Google. You know, you all can go and get that information. But what I thought today is to share this information, which is so much, you know, important for us to understand that perspective. What is that person feeling inside? And why is that person constantly holding on to that? Why is he not able to leave that at the first time? Okay. If there are any questions, I would really appreciate that you can write in your chat box till now. And anything which any one of you have not understand, and we'll come to it again. Okay. Now, understanding that we are in a place where we can hold on to all these situations. We can understand that, you know, what's happening. And this is the situation of a person who is really, you know, repatterning it, doing it again, and has to reach to a level that, oh, it is something that I am into a situation that I am being called an addict, or I have, you know, so much of a dependence that I feel that I cannot live without it, or I have reached a situation where I feel that, you know, I am just not able to do that. Do you think that person can be helped? I want all of you to think, be mindful, and then answer, because this, as you have understood till now, is something which is something I'm holding on to my feelings. All the de-addiction centers in across the globe, or in even in our countries, are focusing on how to make this person leave this habit, how to make this person get off it. And I know of families, I know of people who have, you know, just picked up their children from parties, from situations where they were just having an overdose of drugs or alcohol, and they have been, you know, taking them to the doctors, and the doctors have said that, you know, this person is, you know, you have lost your child. He's so much into addiction, and, you know, please take him to a de-addiction center. And then there are these people, you know, even as counselors or people in the de-addiction, and this person is being tied. Young children of the age of even below 18, they have been tied up, and they have been given, you know, like something like shots to, you know, to make them say that, no, you are not going to get this. What are you going to do? Can this kind of a thing be of help? When you say empathy, when you say support, when you say, you know, you want to communicate, I truly understand that. But this person, is he or she ready to take that support? Definitely not at the first time. And I have in my life never seen an addict reaching to the doctor and say, hello, doctor, I'm an addict, please help me. Do you think anybody would come forward and say, hello, please help me, I'm an addict? Why would he? He's so happy. We understood what is the feeling he has. Why would he want to get out of that feeling? So here I open the forum now for discussion in terms of, you know, please put your feedback and tell me what is the first thing which is required from all of us, the first step to understand how can we help this person. please put in the chat box. Or if any one of you wants to, you know, express their feelings, they are more than welcome to make me understand, because from I want to understand what whatever has been given to you, whatever information you've got, do you think just the way our de-addiction centers are working, or just the way, you know, the information we have about the drugs or the smoking or the alcohol, things can be done just by mere counseling, just by mere support, just by showing our empathy? What can be really done at the first step?
Ma'am, may I speak?
Yeah, please.
Ideally, the best way would be first to identify what they are addicted to. Then if we genuinely want to help, finding a person who has actually gone through it, who is an addict, would be better. And if we actually want to help the person, we can get that person to give their own, share their own experiences. Because coming from an addict, the person is more likely to listen to them. Plus the struggles that they will go through, the addicts who have already faced it are in remission, will be able to guide them more and will be more understanding. You know, we can basically show empathy. Basically, what we are showing is sympathy, because empathy is when you have gone through the same thing, but we aren't addicts. We are just trying to help them. So ours is sympathy, but an actual addict can give them the actual empathy and, you know, the contacts, the support group, be the sponsor, all such things. They can show them that their family will also require therapy, because it will be hard for them to adjust very quickly.
Yes. So you are talking about the motivational aspect, ma'am, and I truly appreciate this. So what is actually required for all of us to look at? Like you said, we are all sympathy. You said the perfect thing. You nailed it. We are doing sympathy. We need to show empathy. And how can we show empathy? By understanding, by changing our mindsets, by understanding this perspective that this person is in a happy zone, though he has substituted. So what I'm going to do is, for example, I'm holding on to something very negative. This is my negative. And what I've substituted is something which was very positive, right? I substituted it with a feeling of love. Right? So I am actually holding on to this, but I'm just taking this away. What our de-addiction centers are saying? Take the alcohol away. Take the cigarette away. But still that feeling of missingness, I'm still holding on to. Will this help?
Ma'am?
Yes.
Ma'am, I think the point that you said is very important. We often just... when we talk to people like these, we often talk to them in a very negative way. We say, you are doing this only, you are doing that only. It is very important that we choose our words very wisely in front of them and create a very positive environment and show them a lot of love. Not by saying that we love them, or not by telling them that you mean a lot to us, but actually talking with them in a very positive way rather than continuously putting negative comments on them.
Perfect.
And the family also, they always say that you are like this only, you are not going to improve yourself, or you're not going to leave all these things. But it is more important that we choose our words very wisely when we are talking to such people.
Wonderful.
That would impact a lot.
Wonderful feedback. Thank you.
Yes, Sumita miss. Yeah. There are some responses in the chat box for the question which you had posed. I would just like to read that quickly. Some of them have said they have to reach rock bottom first. That's when the consequences seem real. Some say, yes, be approachable to them. There are also people who say it is very difficult to help. You feel, because you are feeling helpless, that you can't help them. Then some of them say, by asking what is wrong and assuring him or her that everything will be all right, show love and affection, then the addict is just waiting to be back and out of the rehab. And it is a gradual process. So maybe immediate response from them won't come. Then we try to extend our help. And there are responses like, let them know. Alcohol is not only support they have. Sure, they know that they have a...
Kudja. Hello?
I think it's pillar. It has come as older, but I think it's a pillar. That means a support. We have some support.
Yes,
ma'am, that's all. And there are some questions, definitely, but you would be first talking about it and then pick the questions. Yes ma'am.
So what I was explaining is when I'm holding on to this, which is the addiction, and at the same time, I know this addiction is a substitution. It is a substitution for all those feelings which I wanted to hold on to, which were there somewhere missing in my life. Like in all the examples, what we saw, remembered and what we all discussed was when, for example, when I'm in my most, deepest way of losing something or there's a fear, there's this feeling of feeling helpless. I can't do anything. I'm feeling lost. There is this feeling I'm holding on to and I'm substituting constantly. Even if I'm removed this addiction, how am I able to understand that this feeling, what I'm holding on to, is still there? And even after so many times of, doing de-addiction, somewhere I can come back to it. Because until and unless I don't work on this feeling. So when we say we can help, what we can help them is to first accept them. To make ourselves believe in them that yes, there is an issue in your life in terms of why you are holding on to this. Why at the first place, when you started connecting to this, there was something which was missing in your life. So what are you holding on to is the best question you can ask a substance abuser or an addict. When you want to help this person and ask him that what is, you are holding on to, or what are the people or what are the situations you are holding on to? Are you holding on to something which really, you couldn't hold on to when you wanted to do that in your life? And now you have taken this thing as a substitution. Okay. Because according to the science, which is called Meta Health, our five senses, whenever a conflict happens, whenever a situation like this happens, what happens is a lot of times, actually, I really don't need to, take this glass also in my hand. My five senses has already taken this information. That sight, what I had of that party, that celebration, the smell of alcohol or even the cigarette. So these become my triggers, or I have that taste in my mouth. Okay, the touch what I get when I hold on to these things. So my five senses and the sound what I hear when I, am I in that zone of smoking or drinking or drugs. So all my five senses have taken that information already. And even if sometimes I'm not into the real situation of smoking or drinking, but these just could be my triggers. That is why people in the de-addiction centers really find it hard, because what they keep doing is removing the physical smoke or the smoking or the cigarettes or the alcohol from people's life, from addicts' life. But we really need to understand that the triggers are still inside their brain and they can get re-triggered any time of their life. People, whenever that situation comes in, and what I'm trying to recreate is that feeling of happiness. And why would I not like to recreate that feeling of happiness? So until and unless I am being accepted, I am being made believe that people around me who are there to help me as counselors, as therapists, as teachers, when we are getting into this awareness mode that yes, we need help. We want to help. That we should understand that the first step primarily is to make us understand that change our mindset. They are not bad people. Separate the person and the addiction. I would say, dissociate the person from that addiction and associate the person to that feeling. That is our first step of help and support when we want to provide it. Because until and unless you keep that connection of the person and the addiction together, things will not work. When you can really dissociate the person, this is addiction and you are you. I accept you as a person. I accept you as a human being. And I truly understand what you are going through. And I truly believe in you, that there is something that you are holding on to. But let's understand, what are you holding on to? And then that person goes into a state of awareness that, oh, when the first time I had it, I connected this to a happy feeling. And when my brain connected this to a happy feeling, and I'm recreating that happiness in my life just with this substitute. And then that awareness comes in, oh, it's a substitute. It is not the real happiness. Now, can I find the real happiness in something else? Like, remember somebody suggested me, I would like to take you to dance and tell you to pick, you know, drop your glass down. But till the time you make me understand that, why are you taking me to dance? And why are you asking me to drop this glass? Will I do it? It's our logical brain, which understands only with a reasoning. Okay? Now, just to make things lighter, because we have been doing a lot of discussion around a very heavy topic, you know, I would give you probably a minute from now, or even 2 minutes. I mean, I leave it to you. When you are ready, you can put in your comments. I'm going to show you a slide, and I'm just going to give you a feedback about it, that you are going to see a slide of an old man. Okay, a very old man. All of us have seen a lot of old man, and this is just a slide where I'm going to show you too. So just see and just put in your comments. And if you are able to see the old man, very good. Even if you are not able to see the old man, please let me know what are you seeing in it. Okay. Take a minute and just see it. Okay, so if people have started putting in their comments, I would appreciate.
Yes, Sumita ma'am. Yes, they have already. Should I read out or you want me to wait?
Yeah, so if any of the comments, if all of you have just seen the old man, or is there anything?
No, some of them have written, 1 minute, leaves. They have written it as leaves. Even I felt it was leaves, ma'am. If you would have not told old man, it was like leaves, a rock structure for me surrounded with leaves, actually, what even I felt. Wow. Yes, they have written leaves. Then instead of hair, I see leaves. Old man with many drawing in it. Okay, waterfall. Somebody has written waterfall. Wow. Leaves is most what they have written.
Okay.
Somebody has written, they could see a couple kissing between the leaves.
Okay, wonderful.
Yeah. Then
now with this
response as a landscape. Yes, ma'am. I think then the remaining responses are the same. Yes. Squirrel. Somebody saw a squirrel, and somebody has written, they like now identified the image as Albert Einstein.
Okay, wonderful.
Yes.
So the purpose here was definitely there's an old man, and there's also a perspective of a couple kissing. If you can just cover the upper part, the upper part of this drawing, the forehead on your screen, and you see below the leaves, definitely there are leaves, and below the leaves is a couple kissing. So I just gave you one perspective. So my whole purpose of doing this exercise was, it's a perspective change when we are wanting to help and support. It's a perspective change in ourselves, that when from today onwards, I see somebody so-called an addict or so-called a substance abuser or so-called a substance use disorder, when I see these terminologies, what is the perspective I have about this person or a male or a female or a student? What is my perspective about it? Because I gave you a perspective, most of us just connected to that. And then the new perspective started coming in, and we all started looking at, oh, wow, was it a waterfall also? And was it a squirrel also? So every time when I show this picture, different perspectives come in. And this is the two times, the new perspective had definitely coming off a squirrel. So it is our perspective what we view the situation in. And if I'm in my perspective of just, feeling blocked about this person, and I have my whole situation about this person that, oh, this is how I'm going to view this. Can I really help this person? Can I be of any help or support to this person? Even if I'm, my communication skills are excellent, I'm one of the best counselors, but what am I doing is not able to understand how much the person is feeling inside. So like I repeated, my question when I want to help this person would always be, what is that what you're holding on to, or who are you holding, or a thing or a situation or people in your life, from where you cannot hold on actually to, and you have substituted that feeling, that emotion to a glass or to a cigarette or to a drug. Okay, so this was about this whole exercise, and now I'm going to take you to a small visualization exercise before I start taking in my questions, and we really connect to all the people who have given their feedbacks for questions or any of the slides where you have not understood anything. I can go back and really make you understand. Okay, so I'm just going to play some music. Please let me know if the sound is more. I'll just lower it down, and I'm going to read something for almost 4 to 5 minutes. So if you want, you can close your eyes. Because somewhere I feel that when we are trying to, have that perspective change, and, when we are telling that, this is something which will give you peace and calm. So why not we, understand this peace and calmness within us? Okay. So I'm going to play the music. Give me 1 minute.
The sound, yeah, we can hear the sound, but it is too loud. We can't hear what you are saying.
Better now?
No, little bit much lower, ma'am, so that we can hear you, what you are saying.
Close your eyes. Now it's better?
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
Close your eyes. Let your hand
lungs around 8 feet from this length. Notice your breathing going in and out. In and out. Only feel all the tension, stress, giving you deep breath.
Ma'am, could you lower the voice because whatever you are reading is not clearly audible. Just make it more soft, ma'am.
Better? Now, is it better?
Ma'am, you could lower the voice.
The voice
lower
of
the volume.
You mean the voice of the music?
Ma'am, because we could hear just voice of the music and
is my voice not audible? Or
ma'am, you were not audible because the sound was, the music was very loud.
Okay. Let me just set the music. Give me 1 minute.
I have lowered the music now. Is it better?
Actually, ma'am, then what you are reading is not audible. The music is nice, but
okay. So let us stop it. And I'm just going to read it. Okay. Will that be better?
Yeah, ma'am. That will be fine. Yeah. Okay. That's fine.
Okay. So let's connect again. We did a little breathing and just relaxing our eyes and our whole body. Now imagine yourself sitting on a rock that juts out into the sea. It's a warm and sunny day. As you look down at the water, you see the sun glinting off its surface, making it shimmery and shiny, dazzling you with its sparkle. Carry on looking at the water and gradually you will be able to see more on the glittering surface. You will be able to see the fishes swimming around, fishes that are bright in color, blues and pinks, greens and yellows. As your eyes become used to the fish, you notice of the green fronds of seaweed drifting back and forth in the water being carried by the tide. Sometimes the seaweed covers up the fish and sometimes the seaweed drifts away and you can see the fish. Every now and again, you look into the bottom as you glimpse of the bright colors at the bottom of the sea. Because of all the movements, the glinting of the sea, the fish and the fronds is difficult for you to make out what the colors are. No matter how hard you try to look, it's impossible to tell what is down until a dolphin swims up and from the depths and comes up to the rock and beckons you to join. You drop down on the dolphin's back and here begins your magical journey into the sea. You may find that it is difficult for you to breathe under the water, but as the dolphin carries you down past the fishes and the seaweed, the very bottom of the sea, everything becomes so easy. Once you are there, you can see what it was making the colors. You can see on the sea is the most beautiful mosaic made out of tiny colorful shells. They have been placed together to make a beautiful pattern. It's like looking through a kaleidoscope. You swim across the mosaic, looking through all the sections and taking in the patterns. The dolphin appears and gives you a tiny shell that you decide to add to the mosaic. Carefully, you look for a space where you can fit in your shell. And once you find the place, you place that into that pattern. The dolphin appears again, and as you climb back and begins your journey back home, back to where you began, you look down into the water. You can still see the fishes, the fauna, the green fronds, but now you know where that is on the seabed. and what is there on the seabed. In your mind's eye, you have a picture of that wonderful pattern that you helped to make. That pattern which was your own, and you decided to recreate it in your own beautiful manner. You placed that cell mosaic, and remember, this is your own creation. Slowly, as you are ready to open your eyes and come back to the surroundings, you can breathe in and slowly open your eyes, counting from 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And slowly take a deep breath and open your eyes. Okay, so the purpose of making this visualization exercise was, one, definitely to calm us all and, you know, understand the perspective what we're talking about, because it's a huge perspective shift for all of us to become aware today that what we think is a bad thing, it actually starts from a very good thing. It actually starts from a very happy feeling. And who would not like to stick to that happiness? And why would a person not always try to recreate that happiness in his or her own life? And is it really right for us to, you know, I'm not saying that, you know, we approve of whatever the person is doing, but somewhere each one of us have a right to connect to our happiness in our own beautiful manner. So here, when we are understanding that it starts from a habit, it starts from a very positive stress, as we can all call it. And, you know, it turns into something really shady and stinky and bad. So where a person starts being, you know, we are making that person feel as a loser, where that person is feeling that I'm on the top of the world. You know, I'm a winner in myself because I have recreated this happiness for myself. So it's an understanding and it's a perspective shift. So here I just end my presentation and I'm open now to all the questions and, you know, understanding whatever else has to be done. I'm just going to stop the screen share so that, you know, I'm visible in a better way to people.
Yes, Sumita ma'am. Yes, definitely. Pallavi ma'am, I request you to please take the questions that have been posted in the Zoom chat. Over to you, Pallavi ma'am.
Thank you, Archana madam. Sumita madam, there are a couple of questions here in Zoom chat. One of the questions which was asked is, when you were talking about helping other person to come out of the situation of substance abuse, there's a question which was raised is, what if my friend isn't responding to my help? Then what should I do?
Okay. Understand why the person is not. As we all know, this person, remember I did that role and I said I'm taking this position, you are all wanting to help me. Why will I take that help? Because I don't feel the need to take that help. So going back to all those stages where I underwent and, you know, I made you understand that, what, just ask this person or your friend, what is that? When the first time it started for that person, what was the connection his brain made to whatever the addiction is? So once we understand in a very, that's why I kept my presentation really simple, to understand for a layman, to make us, you know, a better have an understanding about what is the connection my brain has made to that substance, what I'm taking is. It's a habit. It's a, you know, overuse of something I'm doing. But why did I start it? Because I connected it to some happy feeling. And no, that's why I said no addict will come forward and say, hey, I need help. Because they don't need help. They are very happy in the zone they are. It's, you know, it's a difference for the society. It's for the others, it's a challenging situation. It is not a challenging situation for the addict. I don't need help. Why would I want, and, you know, respond to you when I don't need help? Okay, hope that answers.
Yes, yes. Thank you, madam. Next question is by Roshni Besuna. She's asking, people are very much addicted to gaming also which is medium of venting out their stress or frustration, when said to come out of it, aggravates their behavior. So what can be done to help them to get rid of this habit?
When that person is getting addicted to gaming, the same, I would say the rule applies to everything of addiction, you know. When I'm sitting in front of the screen, that screen is not doing anything except, you know, giving relief to my brain. And when the first time I sat in front of that gaming, I connected gaming it as a fun thing, as a moment of happiness, you know, as a way of relaxation, because somebody connected to me gaming. I was born with a gaming, this thing, you know, like how we see children doing it. And I have an 8-year-old daughter, and whenever she has a, you know, like she has a limited screen time, and with this COVID situation in, and definitely all of us have gone to, you know, learning using this, you know, we have taken it as a positive stress of sitting in front of laptops and our gadgets for hours and hours, you know, because we know we are learning. But definitely this is not a substitution. Though right now it is a substitution for our online, offline thing, you know. So with this situation coming in, it is very likely that all the kids, you know, they get onto this because it is we have connected. Our brain has made this connection that this is a positive situation. So be it gaming, be it even work, be it sitting in front of the gadget. Every time when I'm sitting in front of the gadget, I am not being questioned. So if my situation at home or wherever my workplace or whatever is that, you know, there is something which is not making me feel happy, but this time is my own time. Nobody is really, you know, it's like at my beck and call, I can do whatever I want to. I am in control when we are playing games or, you know, when we are doing. So it's just at the control. It's just one click and I can do, I can create, I can have fun. So why will I not connect to it? So definitely when I'm looking to help this person or, you know, so I'm actually asking him what happiness is he getting from this situation can be recreated in something like a physical activity or, you know, playing badminton or, I mean, anything where it is apart from this. Maybe you can, you know, ask your friend or the person to make a list of the activities. What are the other things which he's getting, you know, high on, you know, because we all know it's a substitution. Right now also, do we think that we have done this for 1 year? We have studied online for 1 year. Can we really think that whole our lives we can do that? It's really very traumatic for all of us to even think about it, you know. We know what we have faced through. We all know this is a substitution. And we have really done wonders with this substitution. We have created a new whole world with this learning. But can we all resort to this substitution? Or we are really looking forward for that real thing? It's a substitution. So to become aware of it, that this gaming or this addiction is a substitution. And somewhere my brain has connected it to positive feeling. These are the just two basic rules, if you understand, or you make the other person understand, life becomes much sorted, I would say. Yes.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. So actually, gaming is and mobiles are now the problematic in most of the houses. So you'll find small kids are being substance abused for them is with those gaming. There's another question by Shivani Singh. She's asking, are there any things or precautions that we can do when we visit a pub to avoid alcohol politely, to avoid peer pressure, possible spike drinks?
Are there any? Your voice got cracked.
Are there any things that when you visit a pub to avoid alcohol politely, to avoid peer pressure or possible spike drinks?
I would say it's a choice. You know, like you said, you know, like when I did that role play and I avoided it the first time because I said I come from a family where nobody drinks, nobody does. But when you know, when people are telling you that this is a positive connect, and in your curiosity, you want to try it, there is no harm in trying it. There are people who are social drinkers. I'm not saying that it's that's why I said it always starts with a positive thing. And gradually it will become a habit. And very gradually you will substitute it. So that red signal you have to be aware of. That is it becoming a habit? Because I'm substituting it with the real happiness or with the real feeling. You know, I'm not saying that, you know, if I'm a teetotaler or I'm a non-smoker, I'm not telling the whole world to be converted into that. But it is just that you need to be, you know, vigilant and aware about it, that where is the line, the thin line where I'm crossing, where I'm getting this into a habit or into a situation that, oh, I can't live without it. I need to have this or something will happen.
Ma'am, may I intercede for a while?
Yes.
Ma'am, can means like as educators, can we like drop hints to the students that if you wish to avoid consuming alcohol or if you don't like it, then it would be better to like order a juice or something and not to accept drinks from strangers unless it's poured right in front of you, you know, to avoid spiked drinks? Or would it be like crossing the line when we
suggesting, you know, your suggestions. But like I said, ma'am, it is that situation where that person is. If I'm in the pub and I'm celebrating, I really want to have a, you know, feel of it. I really want to be, because it is about belongingness. You know, this generation, this, the college, the youth, you know.
So it's mostly like for standard 8th to 10th children, like we can't usually promote it like it's all right and we accept it. So any things that will, you know, positively but without crossing the line, nudge them away. So like our professional boundaries are still maintained. Yes. But we have suggested to them that, you know, these are the precautions you can take. Like in case by chance something happens, we can't tell them that it's all right to consume, because it would be.
I'm not at all saying. I think when you enter a pub, the age is 18 years, if I'm not wrong.
So it's mostly like we have noticed that the kids tend to post it on social media that they have it in their houses and their friends' houses.
Yes.
So we do come to know that they have, you know, they are introduced to that. But like we are trying to, you know, nudge them away from that completely so that they don't dive into it at all. Like, and when they do, they are completely informed. And, you know, as adults, they know that they have their own responsibility, because as kids, they might find it fun. Yes. So we were trying to look out for any ways that we can gently nudge them away. But professional
trying to nudge them away, the first thing has to be that awareness coming in from the way I explained, that, you know, you can understand that it is a fun thing. But are you substituting it for a feeling of real fun? Because this is not real fun. How many times can you sit in your friend's house and have this real feeling of, you know, just having a party? It could be once a year or something like that. And
I'm sorry to interrupt, but nowadays the generation kids, the working parents go. So now it's very easily available for the kids to have parties every alternate days as well, ma'am.
Yes, definitely. That is what I'm saying, that when they are not aware about this whole situation, that this is a temporary thing and this can get ourselves into a position where I'm into an addict. I'm into a substance abuser. So unless and until I become aware of it, and I would say also suggest, you know, there is this responsibility of the parents, because somewhere as working parents, you know, we all know what's happening in the houses. So it's, you know, if we all can shirk from our responsibilities, it's very easy to put the whole blame on the child. But I have always believed that when I work with children, it is first thing I work with the child's environment. There is something in the child's environment which is making the child go into that party day in and day out again. There is some feeling of love and belongingness which the child is getting with his peer group, which he is not getting at his house. So why are we not looking at that? Why are we not, you know, making ourselves so much competent enough to, you know, make our own child feel loved and belonged? I know of houses, I know of parents who say, you know, tell their children, sit with us and drink. Because see, it's a situation. When they see their parents drinking, you know, in the house, and it's a culture. I understand there are these culture in the houses that people, you know, everybody in the family sits and drinks. It's a cultural thing. So you, I'm not against anything. I'm just telling you that even if, see, I know of very small children, you know, I've seen in front of my own eyes, where once when the parent is drinking, they are actually dipping their fingers and putting in a child's mouth. The child is as small as even a ear less. This is just they're saying, no, it's like, you know, it's a ritual in my family. When I drink, I just make my child also taste it. Because it's okay for my child to drink. If I'm drinking, why not my child will drink? It's a status symbol for people. It's like, you know, we come from a very wide variety of population where we as adults are introducing our children to these drinks. So what do we call that? When we are talking about substance abuse and its ill effect, we are talking about this whole story. And this is a spectrum where I myself as a parent, I am making my child taste it.
So ma'am, are there any like observation markers that we can observe and tell when to differentiate between an introvert and a child who is feeling really low or depressed? That would really help us to, you know, approach their emotional needs.
Remember, there was a slide which talked about the red signals, the physical, the behavioral, the emotional. So very strong is the emotional thing. You know, when the child's...
What I wanted to know is how do I differentiate between who is an introvert and who is feeling depressed? Because the shyness, the physical, you know, staying away, the keeping to yourself is also are also qualities of introverts who sometimes like the their, you know, solitary happiness. They like staying alone. They are achievers also in their own right. But how do I differentiate between which one is which and whom should I help?
So ma'am, if you want to help anybody, when we take a profile of the child, like we, you know, we were talking about, so what we had discussed was a very extreme profile. When you are just looking for a profile where, you know, you want to help this child. So this child will definitely give you, you know, simple signs like, you know, he's not communicating with his peer group. He's not, you know, he's happy to be feeling isolated. He's sitting in a corner or somewhere when the teacher is asking him to, you know, be very attentive or, you know, somewhere his focus, his concentration levels are very low. So these are like, you know, real markers where we can just, you know, connect with the child and ask what's happening in the child's life to understand what is he, because we understand introvert, but there is something that sometimes the child is not feeling comfortable to express. And there is some fear, some anxiety levels, which is coming from the child's environment. Because as teachers, what we see children is a very specific limited period of time. And apart from this, the child is at home. So if there is something which is happening in the child's environment, you know, with his loved ones, and, you know, there are a lot of cases when we talk about abuse, this is something which is really happening in a very, you know, a silent manner in our society, where we are not even talking about things. And it is happening with our very near and dear ones, you know, abuse, like, you know, to very small kids. It's the age group of 0 to 5 years when abuse happens. So I'm talking about sexual abuse here. You know, when the child is so much into connected to somebody and the child is not, and remember always abuse happens with the most closest ones. You know, a stranger will not come and abuse your child. It is the very close circle of your family or friends where the abuse is happening. And we are not making our children aware about it. The child doesn't know, is it really an abuse or it is just a game or a fun thing happening? So a lot of times this can lead to what you are saying as being a loner or being an introvert. And, you know, so that's why I said it's a real tough situation for us as counselor or therapist or teachers to really look for those marker signs. But definitely, if you are finding somebody, you know, getting into this situation, it's always good to, you know, approach the parents and take the profile of the child from them. That is the child doing, because sometimes it is just a you know, a situation where the child is doing that and there's an opposite personality at home. You know, that could also be a situation. I hope I'm able to answer your question.
Yes, Sumita ma'am. Yeah, there are other questions too. One question is, how can we as teachers help approach students who are identified as addicts? What is the first step?
The first step is always to, you know, just, you know, approach them in a manner that you believe them, whatever they are doing or whatever they are, accept them what I am. Because till the time you don't accept me, why will I open up to you? It is today when you all have accepted me only that I expressed myself, you know, as simple as that. Till the time I'm not feeling connected or till the time I'm not feeling that, okay, when I say something, these people will listen. Because remember, an addict didn't reach at the first place. It took him like a process to reach there. And when he has reached there, we all went through that, what we feel. There is no hope. There is, you know, nobody can help me. I have reached that stage. It's a block I have put in front of me. So only thing what will give me that assurance is that, okay, you accept me. First, accept me. Acknowledge. To karo ki main hoon. I am that person. Because I am always felt like a loser. Why will I, you know, open my mouth in front of you or even talk to you or even tell you that, okay, because I am in my happy place and I'm good to be a loner. It is only you have a problem with me. I don't have a problem with myself. Understand that an addict never has a problem with himself or herself. It is the people around him. It is the loved ones who are giving him all this, you know, story that leave it. You can't do anything. Because he is creating that happiness every time when he's holding on to this.
I'm just wanted to just ask that, yes, after identifying, what as teachers we can do is actually send, we have a school counselor. So the best would be that, because I don't think so as teachers, we are taught to be handling these kids. We are not, we may be a B.Ed, but we are not a counselor. So that is a difference.
I truly understand, ma'am, but this whole, you know, awareness talk, what we did today was just that every person in their own perspective as human beings, we can do this, that we listen. You know, you don't need any counseling degree. Believe me, you just need to accept that person, listen to that person, believe in that person. And just ask this one simple question. When you hold this, what is the feeling you are trying to connect it to? What are you holding on to in your real life? If you just ask this question and make that person's brain think, rather than giving any gyan to him, ye mat karo, ye mat piyo, ye chodo, ye bura hai, he doesn't want to listen. The problem is we start from here only. Our feedback starts from this whole situation. I know of counselors who are all giving this gyan in addiction centers.
So, yeah, Sumita ma'am, yes, I totally agree with you. Not necessary that we need to take the child only to the counselor. As a teacher, it is more important for us to accept the child the way the child is. And as you said, listen, not reject the child totally or exclude what usually teachers do. Are hum kya kar sakte? And that is the point where they will totally exclude the child from their own list of children what they have made. Yes. And the child feels rejected. So accepting, listening, that can happen right from the classroom with the teacher and the other peers who are there. Yes, ma'am, very rightly said.
Because once you accept, you are giving this message to your next person, accept. You are giving this message to the whole community, because if I shirk, from my responsibility, saying, oh, I can't do this. How can I do this? It's okay. You know, that's why I said acceptance is the most difficult thing which we as human beings need to learn. Because believe me, this acceptance and, you know, belief in yourself, this thing actually will just not make you connect to just not addicts, but make you connect to millions and millions of people around you who are looking for that. Your own loved ones, your own family. It starts from where you are inside. And it starts from you, I would say. Have you really accepted yourself? Have I accepted myself the way I am? Because if I'm not able to accept myself, though that's a whole another workshop, I would say, you know, how to accept myself. But at the first place, if I accept myself, then only I can accept you. If somewhere in my personality I'm rejecting, I'm, you know, substituting, or I'm just negating, or I'm just repulsing my own act, I will never be able to accept you as you are. And I will also find the faults, the blames, the whole things what I'm doing to you. So it's a mindset change. It's just not about that the society will, you know, we will just, you know, eradicate some kind of, it's not a disease. We start taking it as a disease. Any mental health disorder, you know, when we connect it to a disease, like a surgeon's approach, and we just start, you know, remove. More than removing, if we are connecting, we need to connect that person, that addict, to his or her own self. And that itself is a biggest job. And that will only happen when you are connected to yourself as a human being and you are ready to listen to that person. You are ready to, you know, accept that person in whatever situation the person is. Because if I'm sitting in front of you with my head down and, you know, my word is stopped, and you come to me and you say, listen, I know this is really challenging. I really accept you. And I will at least look up and look at you. Oh, is this a person who is accepting me? Is this what you said? So I will at least give you eye contact and I will at least, you know, look at you. Otherwise, I don't want to look at you because everybody is telling me I'm wrong. I'm a loser. So it's just that being human, I would say, you know, it's a very innate human quality which we all need to develop in terms of mindset change.
Yes, ma'am, there are a few more questions. Can we take them?
Sure, sure.
Okay. The next question is, how can I tell my friends not to smoke on regular basis because they are least worried about their health and future?
Yes. Why would that person be worried? See, remember when smoking, like nicotine, when we talk about, smoking never happens in isolation. Have you seen people just, you know, standing alone and smoking? Most of them, one, even in public places or, you know, when we are smoking, what is, you know, for example, I'm working. I'm in an office situation. And I'm really, I have this connection of smoke. You know, when I take a cigarette, I stand and I have somebody coming, like a colleague of mine, and standing with me. You know, we are just standing and smoking. We are talking. So is that just the smoking which I came out for that break? Or I actually wanted somebody to listen to me. I actually wanted somebody to, you know, stand with me and listen to me. Listen to all the situation, what I'm at home, what are the challenging situations, you know, I'm facing with my husband or my children or my in-laws. And I just told everything when I was doing that smoking. So that smoking break was just not that smoking break. It was actually my talking break. I wanted to take a break from that isolation. I wanted to take a break from that, you know, that I wanted to just express myself. So if your friend who is, you know, smoking, and you are just telling him, no, it's not good for your health, believe me, nobody will listen. You can do it as a social experiment. All of you who are here today on this platform, you know, go back and connect to one person. Connect in both ways, I would say, if you really want to understand. Connect in both ways. First, give all that gyan and see that person will become so repulsive with you. Then, if you want to really, you know, help that person, connect to that person by just saying that, you know, I believe in you. I understand that when you are smoking, what are you actually trying to do? Make awareness to that, you know, person's brain. Make that change in his brain. Bring that awareness to him that when you were smoking, that holding and talking, that isolation getting over, that feeling of belongingness, what you felt at that moment when you are talking to the other person who is smoking. And most of the time you will never see that I'm standing like this and person in front of me is smoking. It is always two people smoking together. Or it is always two people, you know, holding the glass together, because it is that feeling of belongingness. I will never judge you. It is being judgmental. What we all as non-alcoholic people, non-smoker people do to the people who smoke and drink. And that is why they stay away from us. Like, I have a group of friends who are like social drinkers. You know, I sit with them very comfortably and they all question me. How come you are so comfortable when, you know, in a party, you know, you don't drink. You just hold your glass of water or a mocktail and you sit so comfortably with us. I said, because it's your choice. I'm not here to give you any gyan. It's your choice, but it is up to you to understand that this feeling can be recreated, because I can feel the, create the feeling of happiness with a glass of water. I have that ability in me. If you have that ability in me, why don't you hold a glass of water and, you know, create that happiness? It is a choice. And somewhere I choose to do that. Nobody stopped me from drinking, even if when I became an adult. And even to my own daughter, I don't know tomorrow, even if she's coming from a family background, she tomorrow chooses to do that. And I will always give her this same thing what I'm telling today. Not telling her to stop. Because the moment you tell this instruction, the, you know, like I said, when I tell you think about this, you will do the same thing. When I said don't do this, you will still do the same thing. Our brain is not meant to understand the instruction of no at any cost. The brain will do the same thing. Even if you say no, don't smoke, don't drink, they will drink and smoke. That don't is somewhere in silence. So rather than using don't, you know, why don't we use the do's? Why don't we accept that person?
I think, ma'am, you have answered the next question actually, which was there. How should a parent help a drug addict? And also how to deal with withdrawal symptoms. But somewhere when you were talking, you already have touched upon these points, yeah, with respect to these symptoms.
Definitely are coming after, because you are really, you know, like withdrawal symptoms comes in addiction centers. Like I said, when they are being tied, you know, when even as parents, they are told, you know, remove all these things, don't do this, and, you know, give something like a substitute. But for them, taking those substitutes are not giving that happen. When you're not able to create that feeling, it's a withdrawal. You will withdraw from that. You will stay away from that thing because you want to create that same feeling, which is not coming, which will come when even from a distance you see somebody, forget distance, even if you watch a, you know, on the screen somebody smoking, you will get that smoke because it's in your five senses. It is the first time when you did smoking or drinking or drugs. Those our five senses have taken in those feelings. And to de-trigger is the most challenging one. A lot of people, you know, even as, people who have come out of this also, like you said, somebody, I think, said that, you know, we can introduce that person to somebody who's always been an addict and, you know, left it. So even to those people, the triggers have not been worked upon because they also don't have that awareness that, oh, our brain have still got the triggers. And a lot of people say, you know, when I see somebody smoking, I really feel the urge to And that urge you never know will come to actually you holding on to the secret. So.
Yes, ma'am. Right. Very rightly said. And I think we can go on with this interaction and discussion like that. But due to paucity of time, we will have to stop. And definitely, if there are any more questions, we'll post the questions to you, ma'am.
Sure.
Yes, if they come, we will definitely post it to you. And participants, we will also post the answers on the WhatsApp group, whatever the responses are from ma'am. Ma'am, it was an excellent session, and all the participants, we can see the way they interacted and reacted to the entire webinar talk. It was really that you have touched their hearts with respect to the topic, which is so important for them to know as an individual and as a teacher also. And like ma'am, as you said, I myself and Pallavi ma'am, we can very proudly say we are teacher training college, but definitely when it comes to training the future teachers, first we start training them to be very humane, to be a human being first, and then later all the methodologies and the technique which they have to use in the classroom for the particular subject, they come much, much later. You can ask our new L5 batch also, the 1.5 week where after they have joined, they have gone through the extensive training on different topics where it will help them a lot. And definitely that is one of the most important aspects, to be humane first. So ma'am, I would request Pallavi ma'am to please propose the vote of thanks, formal vote of thanks. Pallavi ma'am, over to you.
Archana ma'am.
Yeah. Pallavi ma'am, will you be able to do it? I think some connectivity issues, Sumita ma'am.
Okay.
Yeah, she is here.
Yeah, Archana, go ahead.
Yeah.
Am I audible?
Yeah, yes, Pallavi ma'am, you are.
I'm
yes.
Out. Okay.
Can I say something?
Oh, on my screen, everybody is freeze.
Yeah, we
can hear you, Pallavi ma'am. Even your screen is freeze for us, but we can hear you.
Okay. Ha.
I think there is a lot of network. She is in the college, ma'am. Yeah.
I understand.
Hello.
Yes, Pallavi.
Hello, Archana ma'am. You can go ahead. I think
okay,
there's a
okay.
lot of connectivity
okay.
for you.
Okay.
Yeah. You can go ahead.
Yes, Sumita ma'am. Sumita ma'am, you wanted to say something before I start. Yeah.
I said before you express your word of thanks, I would really like to express my word of thanks to all of you for being such a wonderful audience, for giving me this, way of connecting to so many people and spreading the message. And what I've learned from my mentor, Anu Mehta, who has given me this, real great skill of, getting into this topic so deeply. The way, because I was just reading some comments which they say the explanation, because I really didn't want to get into the technical explanation way. I always felt that explanations can be dealt more with the role play or with the interactive session. And also before I just finish my word of thanks, expressing my thanks to Dr. Archana, Dr. Pallavi for being such a great support, to Principal Ma'am for inviting me on this platform. And also, before I end, I would also like to appreciate my husband who did this whole presentation, made up for me, because I'm really struggling in all these way of making the presentation. So all these people who have been my support, so where I can do, and here I'm actually in Delhi, I'm not in Mumbai today, I'm in Delhi for a function and my daughter is being taken care of by my sister. So, you know, we need support of so many people when we come on this platform and do anything. So I feel that, you know, when we are talking as individuals, like, you know, when we think that we are so much capable of doing, we are independent. I feel we are all interdependent. And only one message that I can give to today before I sum up this, that, you know, when we are telling everybody, you know, then addict that, you know, you will not get this peace of mind, you know, leave this. So actually they are in pieces, you know, this profile, this person to whom we are talking is really in pieces. And we are trying to tell him that, you know, you can get peace. So it's really difficult for him to connect from that pieces, you know, that small broken pieces. And here we are to more than giving him peace in terms of P-E-A-C-E. You know, if we can just make him combine his own pieces and make him an individual, you know, from that where we start our journey, that would really be a great way of connecting to anybody whom you feel that that person is an addict. So here I just thank you. On this note, I would just end.
Yes, Pallavi ma'am, since you are here, is it possible? No, I think she has got disconnected again. Yeah, Pallavi ma'am.
Yeah, but I am not able to hear in between. So Archana ma'am, go ahead.
Okay. Sumita ma'am, as I said, it was an excellent session. The interaction, what we had, the discussion, and very rightly said by you, some things cannot be dealt through theoretical explanation. They have to be felt. And through your entire today's session, you made each and every participant feel that the need for understanding these people, the need for accepting these people, and how actually we can help them and support them. That was a great session, ma'am, and a very nice interaction. Thank you very much for that. And again, ma'am, thank you so much for spending your valuable time with us. I know you had shared with me that you will not be available in between this period, but then still I said, ma'am, please see if you can. So I'm very much grateful that you could manage, and sorry that we took your family time away little bit, but you can see how many of them are benefited, ma'am. Definitely. Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you.
So ma'am, on behalf of Gujarat Research Society's Hansraj Jeevanlas College of Education, our principal ma'am, Dr. Anita Swami, the entire HJCE faculty, and all the participants who were with us today throughout, I extend a heartfelt gratitude to you, ma'am, for conducting such an excellent session, for sharing your expertise and your views on this topic, which is so important in today's present era, we would say. And ma'am, like the last point, what you talked about, interdependency. I just remembered this quote from Mother Teresa. If we have no peace, it is because we have forgotten we belong to each other. True. So ma'am, yeah, as rightly said by you, we all are dependent on each other. And that is the reason understanding each other, accepting each other, is the most important thing in the today's present scenario. So ma'am, once again, a big thank you to you. And participants, I would request you all, you can unmute and applaud, a big round of applause for ma'am. You all can unmute, no problem. Thank you so much. Thank you, ma'am. Yeah. Participants, one last instruction. We'll be posting the feedback link on the WhatsApp group. Kindly fill the feedback form, and the certificates you will be receiving within the 15 working days. Of course, we'll be checking your attendance and then posting the certificates to your DE certificates, okay, the soft copy of it. Thank you very much. So thank you, Sumita ma'am. We'll be, ending the meeting. Thank you so much. And you have a great time with the family. Thank you.
Thanks, Mitch ma'am. Shall end meeting for everybody.
Yes, Pallavi ma'am. Yes, please do that. Ma'am.
Yeah. Thank you very much, ma'am.
I think Pallavi ma'am again got locked off. So ma'am, we may have to leave the meeting. Since she is the host, she will be ending it later when she logs in again. Okay, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you very much.